Okay, so the question we all want to know, how do you take control over the low end within your mix? And also, what should have the most low end punch in your mix? Your kick drum or your bass guitar? Welcome to Viewer Questions Answered, episode 12. I finally did it! Frightbox recording t-shirts. There's a link in this video's description. You can click on it and order your very own Frightbox recording t-shirt. And be sure to check back the store over time. I'll be adding other fun pieces of merch to the Frightbox merch store. Again, there's a link below in this video's description. Check it out. So with that out of the way, let's jump into this excellent, excellent group of questions sent in by my loyal email subscribers. Let's check out what we got. Okay, and our first question comes from Ronaldo. Hey, Bobby. I don't know if you already have a video about it, but something I think we, home recordists or home producers, struggle with is to achieve a consistent and powerful low end. It's very hard to know how much low end the kick and bass should have. For example, should the kick hit 4 dB at 50 or 60 hertz? It seems to be even more difficult when you're producing 100% in the box. When I listen to my headphones, it sounds fine, but then a friend listens to it and says it lacks power. Another related question is how to determine if your low end will be driven by your kick or bass. Which one to high pass? And which one should breathe? Thanks a lot, I'm a huge fan. Okay, well, Ronaldo, the question you ask is a very, very, very common problem that we all struggle with when it comes to mixing music, especially heavier genres of music where there's so much happening and things are just really busy and there's just a whole lot happening within the mixes in general. Now, you got really specific with numbers as far as boosting specific frequency ranges, like let's say on a kick drum, should you boost 40 hertz? Should you boost 50 hertz or 60 hertz? And here's the thing that you have to remember, all source sounds are different. Sometimes you might have to boost a little bit of low end. Sometimes you might have to cut low end. And you have to remember, if you were to, you know, keep your EQ flat and boost your top end, you'd in a sense be cutting low end because you're boosting top end and making that range a little more prominent within the source sound itself. So I don't think of mixes in that way. Now, with that being said, I'm gonna share with you how I think of low end and how I personally achieve a nice, tight, consistent low end. Trick number one is that the music has to be recorded right in the first place. In other words, really tight performances, and if the performances aren't tight, really tight editing. That alone will help you achieve a nice, powerful, crisp low end without even having to touch a single EQ or fader or compressor or anything. Get the source right. The next trick that most people don't think of is to high pass your kick drum, even if it's sitting lowest as far as frequency response within your mix. This is because there's usually a bunch of junk, let's say below 30 or 40 hertz, that's just eating up headroom on your master fader, which is gonna cause trouble when it comes time to master your track. In other words, it's using up a bunch of energy that's not actually adding any power to your mix. So that's usually where I start. I high pass my kick at 30 or 40 hertz, and I have my kick sitting the lowest within my mix. Next comes my bass guitar, and I usually roll off my bass guitar anywhere between 60 and 70 hertz. So I think of it almost like a layered cake. I have my kick drum, then my bass guitar, then my rhythm guitars, and then everything else above that. Snare drum, vocals, lead guitars, and then my cymbals are the highest within the mix. So I can't tell you to cut or boost any specific range on these instruments because again, it really depends on the source sounds. Now the frequencies I just mentioned are the roll-off points where I set my high pass filters. So these aren't the frequencies that I'm cutting or boosting. Now I have heard of some mixers, you know, having their bass sitting lowest and then their kick above that. That hasn't really worked for me personally because your kick drum isn't a consistent, you know, sound source. It's part of the beat. And your bass guitar generally is a lot more consistent. So if your bass guitar is sitting really low and your kick drum is lacking power by rolling it off, you know, like let's say to 70 hertz or something like that. I don't know, for me, that just has never worked out that well, but you know, give it a shot. If you like it, stick with it. But what works best for me is what I previously mentioned. Kick, bass guitar above that, rhythm guitars, so on and so forth. Now, the other big trick with low end that most people don't talk about is to take control over your bass guitar as far as the dynamics are concerned. So what I like to do is compress my bass guitar so it's sitting nice and evenly, and then I like to use a brick wall limiter so my bass is really solid and unmoving in my mixes. It seems like such a subtle technique, but for me, it makes a massive difference because you gotta remember the bass is really taking care of a lot of the low end. And if it's nice and consistent, it's gonna make the mix sound consistent overall in the low end. So by combining, you know, these very strategic high pass filter settings and layering your mix properly as far as the low end that exists within your mix and keeping a nice tight cap on your bass guitar, you're gonna have a nice, tight, consistent low end. If you're using tracks that are very tight and or mixed properly, you have to remember that. If your tracks aren't tight, you could whip out every single mix trick under the sun. Your low end will never, ever, ever in a million years sound, you know, powerful and punchy. And I also want to say this, whether you're mixing on a console or in the box, it really doesn't matter. A tight low end comes from your workflow, your process, and your technique. It has nothing to do with analog or digital gear. It's a complete myth. So Ronaldo, I hope that answers your question, and give these techniques a shot and let me know how it works out for you. Okay, question number two comes from Enrico. Hey Bobby, I hope you can answer this question. I saw this video on YouTube about amp sims and I love the tone of that amp sim. And the question is, why does my guitar sound really terrible when I use that amp sim, even though I use the exact same settings and plugins that the guy in the video is using? So I check my guitar DIs, there's no problem with the DIs, they don't sound muffled, fizzy, and the signal's not too hot or clipping. Can you please explain this to me? Thank you so much. Okay, well Enrico, much like low end, the thing that's tricky about guitar tone is there's a lot more that's really involved than meets the eye generally, or at least there's usually much more involved than most people are even aware of. Let me give you some real world examples here. Let's say guitar player A picks up a guitar and plays through an amp sim and records a nice, tight, solid performance. And he double tracks this performance. And then let's say guitar player B picks up the exact same guitar, plays through the same rig, and doubles his tracks, but they're not as tight, he's not digging in hard enough, the background instruments aren't as well carved out in the mix, the overall performance just isn't as cohesive and well played or tight. What'll end up happening is guitar player A's tone will sound significantly better than the second guitar player's tone, even though both tones are near identical or actually are identical. Now, the reason why I bring this up is you have to remember, if you're watching a YouTube video where it's a pro mixer that's demonstrating like an amp sim or something like that, more than likely their drum tones are on point. Everything is nice and tightly edited. Their bass guitar is usually gelling perfectly with their guitars and balanced right, which is adding extra power to their guitars. Just the overall picture makes the guitar tone sound significantly more professional. Now, I've said this multiple times within this video series, but you'd be shocked if you ever heard any pro mixes and listened to the tracks isolated. A lot of the times, the guitar tone isn't that great in isolation, but when you hear the entire mix, the big picture that you're hearing, the tone sounds amazing because remember, we're hearing the entire mix as a whole. Now, here's another thing to consider. You're mentioning that this person is using the exact same settings that you are, but have you paid attention to the exact impulse response that they're using? That's another element that people tend to overlook. So with that being said, if you haven't downloaded my free impulse response, again, download it. There's a link below in this video's description. It's absolutely free. If you're struggling with guitar tone, it can definitely help set you in the right direction. If your guitar tone feels like it needs an endless amount of EQ to get rid of fizz and mud and all other types of weirdness, it very well could be your impulse response. So again, you can download mine for free. There's a link below in this video's description. So Enrico, I hope this answers your question. Remember, there's a lot more involved with guitar tone than usually meets the eye. Make sure your performances are dead on, your mix in the background is just as good as the mix that you're hearing in the YouTube video, or at least on par with it, and that you're using a quality impulse response. Because remember, just because you see the settings that they're using in the tutorial, that doesn't mean that he's using the exact same IR that you're using. Just a few things to consider. Thanks for your question. Okay, question number three comes from Sebastian. Hi, first I just want to say that I love your videos and I think it's one of the best channels for metal production right now. The problem I have with vocals is that I can't really glue them with the instrumental. Maybe it's just me, but I want to know what you think. Greetings, Sebastian from Argentina. Okay, well Sebastian, thank you for your question, and I'm definitely gonna be doing some more tutorials on this topic because it's something that we all struggle with. I know I used to struggle with it a lot. Now back in the day when I would record vocals, especially like harsh metal vocals, I always thought my, you know, vocal mix never sounded right because I didn't have, you know, high-end preamps. What it actually ended up turning out to be is that I wasn't using saturation and distortion efficiently when mixing my vocals in my metal productions. Let me give you an example. Let's say you have a metal mix, you have your drums sitting right, bass guitar sitting right, your guitar tone is sounding great. When you plop the vocals in and the singer is screaming, or even if there's, you know, clean vocals, a lot of times they'll sound weirdly separate from the music. What beginners tend to do is they add a ton of reverb to help the vocals sit in the mix. Now, there's nothing wrong with reverb. That's an artistic and a stylistic choice. But what usually ends up helping the vocals sit in the mix properly is blending in some tape saturation with your heavy vocals. Something that I even do sometimes is I'll take like a stomp box, like a metal stomp box pedal, something that I would never actually use on a guitar track, and I'll take a send on my vocal track, send it to the, you know, metal zone or metal stomp box pedal, and blend in that really saturated tone, vocal tone, with the dry vocal. You don't notice the distortion in the mix, but all of a sudden your vocal sounds more musical and just sits really nicely with the guitar tracks. In other words, the vocal ends up not sounding too separate from the mix. It might sound really counterintuitive, especially if you're a beginner, but give it a shot and I think you'll be amazed at how much it really helps blend your vocal in with the rest of the track. So Sebastian, just give some saturation a try on your vocals. It doesn't have to be anything fancy. You can even use a stock distortion plugin within your DAW and let me know how that works out as far as gluing your vocals in with the rest of your track. Keep me posted. Okay, and our final question comes from the band Inquiring the Dead. Bonjour, my band is a two-piece rock duo and we've been having trouble finding an engineer to mix and master our first few songs. We're both 21 years old and paying rent, so we don't have a huge budget to work with. We're looking at the $180 and $200 range per song, and we record our own tracks at home. We understand proper recording etiquette as well as editing files properly for mixing. The real challenge has been finding an engineer who, number one, appreciates our musical vision, two, wants to build a long-lasting relationship, and three, is in our budget. So the question is, how does a young band in the industry find a harmonious relationship with an engineer while still having money for marketing, music videos, after paying for mixing? As a side note, the fact that we are a paranormal, mystical, gothic rock band makes it all the more difficult for people to want to work with us. Okay, well, Inquiring the Dead, this is an excellent question, and it's something that I face as a professional mix engineer on a near daily basis. Here's the thing, man. You know, you're mentioning a range from $180 to $200, and you have to remember, mixing is a very involved process. Now, me personally, I charge between $500 and $750 per track, and that's for a very specific style of music. That's for shorter songs and a very simple track count. Now, most people might think that's expensive, but again, you have to remember all the file prep, communicating with the band, mix notes. Mixing takes a lot of effort and time. Now, if you want a truly professional product and you don't want to pay a lot of money, you really only have one option, and that's to hire an up-and-coming mix engineer that's extremely talented. Now, I say this because, again, someone who has more experience and is a little more established, that's a really, really low rate. Now, the great thing about hiring an up-and-coming engineer is that as your career progresses, their career will also be progressing, and as their rates increase, you'll be able to afford their higher rates, because if they're talented, they will increase, I promise you. Again, you have to remember that metal production takes a lot of work, a lot of time, and a strict attention to detail. So $200 a song is really, really cheap. So keep me posted on your progress. I'd love to hear if you finally snag up a talented young engineer that's within your budget. So Inquiring the Dead, thank you for your question. Okay, I'd just like to shout out and thank everyone for this excellent group of questions. And remember, if I haven't gotten to your question yet, be patient. I will definitely get to it within one of these upcoming videos within the series. And again, remember, if you're interested in a Frightbox recording t-shirt, there's a link below in this video's description to the Frightbox merch store. If you found this video helpful, like, comment, subscribe, and share. And do not forget to click the little bell icon so you can be notified every time I upload one of my weekly videos on all things metal and rock production. You can both like and follow me on Facebook and Instagram. Links are in the description below. And don't forget to download my free Guitar Cab Impulse Response. There's a link below in this video's description. Download the IR, load it into your favorite amp sim plugin, and get right to dialing in killer metal guitar tone with ease. Again, there are links below to the merch and the free IR. Till next time, happy mixing.